But there's a sense also of certain things he suffered. And the reason he suffered them is so that we can be free. What's my challenge to us today, child of God, is that you have to walk in dominion. What's my challenge to you today, child of God, is that you have to live the Christian life. You're born again. The life of God is in us. Sin does not have dominion over us. We can reign. Yes, we're going to reign in the street by and by. When we get to heaven, have the marriage supper. Yeah, thank God for that. But listen, we're to reign now. We're to reign now. Because he suffered in our stead, in our place. So you shouldn't be suffering satanic dominion. You shouldn't be suffering being dominated by circumstances. You shouldn't be suffering being dominated by sin. You shouldn't be suffering being dominated by sickness. No, he suffered all that. And he suffered it in our place. He suffered it as our substitute. In Philippians 3:10, he said, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. He said, and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto death or unto his death. If by any means I might attain unto the resurrection of the dead, say not as though I had already attained, either were already perfect. So Paul wanted to know the fellowship of his sufferings. Yes, there are certain things we fellowship in his sufferings, you know, the shame of the cross, preaching the gospel, living for God. But there's a sense also of certain things he suffered. And the reason he suffered them is so that we can be free. What's my challenge to us today, child of God, is that you have to walk in dominion. What's my challenge to you today, child of God, is that you have to live the Christian life. You're born again. The life of God is in us. Sin does not have dominion over us. Sin does not have dominion over us. You see, holiness is not a curse word. Some Pentecostals seem to think it is. Some Pentecostals and charismatics, Pentecostals and charismatics, they seem to think it is. It's not. It's not. Thank God we can live holy. We can live victoriously over the flesh, over the world, over the devil. Amen. We can. That's the essence of all these things. For us to live that life. The life of Christ. In Hebrews chapter 2 verse 9. The Bible says there. Talking about his suffering still. But we see Jesus. Who was made a little lower than the angels. For the suffering of death. Crowned with glory and honor. That he by the grace of God should taste death for every man. So he suffered in our stead. Hebrews 9:26. Talks about how he put sin away by the sacrifice of himself. He says, for then must he often have suffered since the foundation of the world. For now once in the end of the world. One rendering says, now once where both worlds met, the old covenant, the new covenant, those both ages where they meet, have he appeared to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Jesus put away that sin nature. He put it away. It's not just our sins. If all that he died for was so that we can have remission of sins, then it's a matter of time we produce more sins. And then we'll keep needing forgiveness. No, he dealt with sins, yes, but he also dealt with sin. That consciousness, that nature, that law that compels people to do wrong, he put it away. He put it away by the sacrifice of himself. In 1 Peter chapter 1, the Bible talks about certain things that searching what or what manner of time the Spirit of Christ, which was in them, Old Testament prophets, did signify when it testified beforehand of the sufferings of Christ. And notice, and the glory that shall follow. So there's a glory that's to follow the sufferings. Amen. We're to walk in that glory now. Yes, there's more to come. There's an eternity with God. There's the new heaven. There's the new earth. But we can have some heaven now on earth to go to heaven with. Godliness is profitable to all things, having promise of the life that now is and of that which is to come. Yes, it has promise of the life that's to come, but it also has promise of the life that now is. It has promise of the life that now is. So we suffered with him. 1 Peter 3, verse 18. The Bible says here that for Christ also, as one suffered for sins, so he suffered for us, the just for the unjust, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive by the Spirit, or made alive in the Spirit, one translation puts it. So he suffered in our place. He paid the price. Romans 4:25 says he was delivered up for our offenses, and he was raised up for our justification. The marginal rendering says he was delivered up on account of our offenses, and he was raised up when we were declared righteous. Those 3 days and nights that he spent, remember, his deity, we are humanity. 1 hour of deity suffering is worth more than an eternity of humanity suffering. And he suffered it all. God was just in our redemption. He was just. He was fair. He was righteous in his dealings with man. He was righteous in his dealings with the devil. He was righteous in his dealings with his own word, with his own law. He was righteous. Amen. He played fair. He was perfectly just. Perfectly just. There were all kinds of allegations. God, didn't you know that man was going to sin? Why did you still create him? Blah, 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 blah. Couldn't you have done this? Couldn't you have done it? So God said, all right, you guys, hold on. He decided to assume the liabilities of Adam's transgression. That's why Romans 3, 21 to 26. The Bible there talks about this, said that he might be just, verse 26, and the justifier, that he might be righteous, and the righteousness of them that have faith in him. You see, he's our righteousness. He was righteous in that redemption. It was legally done. Completely legal. He served that sentence and served it in full. That's why he went to hell, so I don't have to go there. And you don't have to go there either. All a man needs to do is to put his faith in that substitutionary sacrifice. The moment a man accepts Jesus into his heart, believing that God raised him from the dead, identifying with that substitutionary sacrifice, then everything that Jesus did becomes that man's. Because Jesus did it in our place. Jesus did it in our stead. We suffered with him. We suffered with him. Thank God for the glories that are to follow. Amen. He paid that price. He paid it in full. Now, obviously, I'm not finishing this today. It's fine. But he paid it in full. He paid it in full. Now, I had a dream a few days ago. And I'm going to tell you a part of it. Listen, in Luke 10:19, the Bible says, behold, I give unto you power. Jesus was speaking, authority, that first word means, to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. And he said, nothing shall by any means hurt you. Because of the death, burial, and the resurrection of Christ, we can live in absolute dominion over the forces of darkness. So the devil hasn't gone on vacation. Are you listening to me? He's not on recess. He didn't have Easter holiday. You might have. He didn't. He walks wakajubeto and fro, up and down. And what is he doing? He's looking for who to devour. Can he devour a Christian? He sure can, if the Christian will let him. Ephesians 4:27 says, neither give place to the devil. That means the devil can take place in your life if you give him. But that also means he won't take place in your life if you don't give him. Jesus said, I give unto you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the ability of the enemy. And what did he close that verse with? He said, and nothing shall by any means, shall in no wise hurt you. Nothing shall by any means hurt you. In Psalm 91 verse 13, he said, you will tread upon the lion and the adder. The young lion and the dragon you will trample under feet. Now, when he said you tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon, what was he talking about? He's talking about the devil's fiercest attacks. Will the devil come against you? You see, I heard something a preacher said many years ago. He said, if you and the devil never have a head-on collision, then you're both going in the same direction. Are you listening to me? Yeah, if you and the devil never have a head-on collision, you're going in the same direction. So he's going to come against you because you're leading the lost to the saving knowledge of Jesus. But you know, that's where the fun is, to stand our ground against him. We are not ignorant of his wiles and his devices, but we are not afraid of him. We tell him, and I'm telling him, and he's hearing me, devil, we dare you. You are not big enough. Amen. Why? Because we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Because greater is he that is in us than he that's in the world. So what do? We stand our ground on God's word. We simply stand our ground. The Bible says, having done all to stand, stand therefore. Because of that death, the burial, and the resurrection of Christ, because of the things that Jesus suffered, because of the price that Jesus paid, and Jesus paid that price and paid it in full, the devil has no right over you. The devil has no right over me. And you don't have to let him exercise any. Now, if you let him, he will. He is a rebel holder of authority. He is a usurper. If you let him, he will. If you refuse, you see, power doesn't lie in a vacuum. If you refuse to use it, he will try to use it on your behalf and use it against you. So use your authority. Stand your ground on the word of God. You are who the word says you are. You have what the word says you have. Amen. We reign today as kings. God the Father said to the Lord Jesus, said, sit at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. How is God making his enemies his footstool? Through the church. He said, the Lord crushed Satan under your feet shortly. How is God going to crush Satan under Jesus' feet? Through the church. By us standing in our dominion. By us standing in our authority.